So today I'm going to talk about this idea of maturity model for microservices. So I'm going to talk about three things, actually. And I'm going to build up to the maturity model because I want to explain why this is relevant to what we do. It's not a commonly like an industry pattern. It's something that we created in our own infrastructure to manage this problem of dependency hell in microservices. And I'll talk about a little bit more about that. And that's point number one. The second thing we're going to talk about is how do you distribute these microservices and create boundaries between your system. And we'll touch upon this idea of domain-driven design. It's a massive topic. I will definitely not have enough time to talk about it in 20 minutes, but I want to make sure that I set the premise so that the people who have probably not had familiarity with this idea go and touch upon this a little bit in the future. So I know how you guys have all heard about Postman and hopefully used Postman before, so that is great. How many of you guys use microservices? Okay, perfect. How many of you guys are from the business side of things? Oh, not a lot, okay. So I'm assuming the rest of you guys are technical, right? Great. So, presentation, by the way, is going to be both about business and technical. So we're going to have a little bit of a mental leap, and I hope you guys can follow along with me, right? So I've been with Postman since the very beginning. Postman as a product was launched first in 2012, and I wrote the first OAuth 1 plugin for this product, and it was really bad, by the way. So if it didn't work for you back in 2012, you can blame me for that. But I have obviously been very, very passionate about APIs. Postman has come a long way since 2012. We started formally as a company in late 2014, and we have currently Postman in, being used by more than 6 million developers in more than 200,000 organizations around the world. And it is being now used more than it's just a REST client aspect of Postman, but doing more and more aspects of the API management workflow within the product. So when we started the company in late 2014, we had a really popular product called Postman, of course.
With about 650,000 users in every single country in the world, I guess, in like the most fun metric that I like to share. And we had only a four-member engineering team. Three of us were founders. And at the time, microservices were really, really popular. And it was pretty much like at the top of the hype cycle. So we started breaking our backend system down. And as engineers who loved abstractions and these forward-thinking architectures, the benefits of microservices, you know, using whatever tools that is there to solve a particular problem, or polyglot architecture, all of these things made so much sense. Like, okay, this sounds great, right? And then we found ourselves in this situation, which is commonly known as a dependency hell. So dependency hell basically comes from the software package management world. It basically means that I am developing a piece of software and I have certain dependencies, which in turn have certain model dependencies and so on. And you basically get into this weird little mesh where you might end up in situations of circular dependencies or vulnerabilities in different parts of the system. And then you end up what is colloquially referred to as the dependency hell. And you can extend this idea to the concept of microservices, which is also based on different systems that connect and work together and effectively can create a situation of a dependency hell, right? And this basically means that the similar problems that you had compounded with the effects of building a distributed system, and that's really not a great place to be in. And this is where we ourselves found. And there's certain symptoms that, you know, you can recommend if you're managing or building a microservices architecture. You have this system where one service fails, all of them fail. Services need to be deployed together,
and which is usually requires expensive cross-team collaboration to align roadmaps around these releases. And what we really found out over time as we thought more about it is that this happens due to a lack of
clearly defined service boundaries. And we found this ourselves in our own team. You know, sometimes I'll hear a developer, hey, you know what, Ankit? This seems like I should build a new microservice here. You know, I have a feeling this should be a different microservice. And I'm like, okay, that sounds great. And the second aspect is you have more experienced developers who have more context with the development stack, and they end up building a functionality, which is business feature requirements, in places where they don't belong. But just because I'm more familiar with a certain part of the code base, and which basically means that, you know, you're not really defining these boundaries, these microservices, which is why they came up with in the first place. And what you end up with is this idea of a distributed monolith, which is a monolithic architecture which has all the costs attributable to a distributed architecture. So I always went back to this one book, one of my favorites, from Sam Newman, which talks about building microservices. And he outlines these seven principles around microservices design. The first one being modeling around business domain. Okay? So when I'm a big fan of this thing, but when I started out figuring this out, and read it more about and read more about the modeling around business domain, I came across this idea, domain-driven design. Has anybody here heard about this term or practiced it before? Okay, good. So a few people, right? So domain-driven design comes with great terminologies like this. Domain-driven design models a ubiquitous language in explicitly bounded context. Okay, so first time I read this, I was like, okay, let's close the book and let's move on. Let's try to, there are six other things that are mentioned here. Let's try and follow that, those other principles, right? But constantly kept coming back to this idea over and over and over again, that the idea is that the microservices themselves need a clear boundaries to be defined before you can start executing on them. So I'm going to try and do something interesting here. I'm going to consciously be semantically slightly fluid and not exactly correspond to terminologies here because they can get a little bit more complex, and focus on the bare minimum to move this conversation forward. Okay? So let's think about this, right? And in the spirit of this event being in the finance space, let's talk about a credit card processing system. So I'm an organization. I start off with building a credit card processing system. And that's the only thing I do as of now, right? So I love writing on walls, right? So imagine that I'm writing on this wall and I've created this big oval and identify all the problems that I have to solve as an organization to this. So I start writing down a few things. You know, there is going to be merchants acceptance workflows. There are merchant financial parameters. There are online transactions that have to happen. There are end of the day, there have to be transactions that happens in credit card systems, clearing process. So you see that you start getting more and more concepts into this process. And as you get more feature requirements, more business concerns come up, you end up in typically what is called as this big ball of mud with so many concepts. And you could choose to implement the system as it is and keep adding more features. And this is the original reason why monolithic architecture started becoming more difficult to manage, is because you have too many concepts. And as new feature requirements come in, you end up implementing them and creating this well-recognized software design pattern, by the way, called a big ball of mud. So, like, hold on. I mean, it doesn't have to be this way, right? So what you really want to, so what domain-driven design talks about is that why don't we break this problem into smaller problems? And the way to break it down into smaller problems is not based on the fact that technically it needs to be a particular way. It is to align it around business processes. So when I'm talking about credit card transactions, what are different things I need to look about from a business perspective? I have to do payments. Then I have to do accounting, where I do clearing transaction at the end of the day and passing it on to the merchant. And of course, there's a merchant process that is involved as well, right? So when you start breaking this big problem into these smaller problem sets, right, it makes the problem a little bit more manageable from where we are. And that's the core idea of domain-driven design, which is creating these smaller boundaries. And the important keyword here is not by technical abstractions, but by creating them around business processes and how it's a reflection of your business process that works, right? And these are obviously vary across different business boundaries. So in this problem space that we had created and in this small problem components that we created, now you are trying to solve those individual problems.
Which is where, in the domain-driven design structure,
these small problems called as subdomains now start transitioning into this solution space, okay? Technically called as a bounded context, right?
So again, point being here is that these boundaries are created on business and not technical concerns.
It's a model of how your business functions. It is aligned around generating consumer value. Think of them as these value delivery units, right? So I'm going to generate value based on this problem that I, in this subdomain, have decided to solve. And now this value itself may be delivered through web, through mobile, through Slack, APIs,
doesn't matter, even a call center.
The point is that it just needs to be around this bounded idea where concepts that belong together under a context that has been set by the business, and you solve those problems. Once you have this problem space divided into these smaller solution spaces, you then create teams. Teams that are isomorphic with these bounded contexts. You create one team who's going to solve this one problem that has been set inside that domain. And teams are cross-functional, because the idea is that now if I were to operate this smaller team as an entire organization, what are the different resources I would like to give to this team to solve that particular one problem, not the whole problem of the company, and start doing that, right? So you create this cross-functional team of developers, designers, product managers, marketers, salespeople if required, and so on, and add this entity called as a domain expert or a set of domain experts who bring the business context back into this picture. These teams are created to be autonomous. They are allowed to take their own decisions and decisions within that problem that they're trying to solve. And the teams themselves become these long-term, they can create these long-term visions around creating a particular problem, solving for a particular problem. For example, I might create a team around managing the identity. So if I am responsible as a team for managing the identity about anything that other systems interact with, I am enabling that particular functionality. And I constantly think about building this, this functionality in the set. And then these smaller units, these bounded contexts, these solution spaces, talk to each other via clearly defined APIs, because the idea here is to reduce the cross-team collaboration that existed between teams, because earlier teams were created around artificial constructs, probably around front-end development and back-end development, or and analytics and so on. So once you have these teams which are cross-functional, do multiple things, but actually deliver value, you are able to create something that is directly aligned to generating the user and not hide the fact that there is a user who's consuming this behind the abstraction of business teams and so on. Okay, awesome. I started a topic with microservices, but where did you go in between, right? So the idea is that microservices boundaries are now created within this bounded context. You don't think about microservices as something that is a small piece of code that can be independently deployed and I can use any technology, but create this boundary and within it implement this business logic through microservices. And this is where this whole idea of microservices came into being in the first place, because it allows you to create this hard boundary, because you have different code, different GitHub repositories in which you are implementing this business logic. So it allows you to specify that, hey, this is where this business concern is going to lie. And these microservices do not cross these boundaries that we had created. But with the one caveat that inside this boundary, you can still split up these microservices on technical concerns. I might want to choose Node.js for a particular problem and Erlang for another set, and that's completely okay. But as long as you do not cross these boundaries that have been created on business needs.
So in summary, it allows you to focus on business value over technical strategy. It enables cross-functional collaboration. It creates teams that have long-term vision and roadmaps around that particular problem space that they are focusing on. And it allows for a clear business logic separation through this idea of microservices. And these teams are only work if they are able to, coming back to the framework, deploy independently, take decentralized decisions, and have the authority and the ownership and the accountability to execute on them. As long as they also hide their own conceptual details behind these APIs. APIs don't have to have a one-to-one mapping with how you talk within your entire organization, but rather are more consumer-driven, the way that people are more consumer. That's how you create these APIs. So now, moving on to the maturity model as well. So now that we've created these domain teams who are responsible for end-to-end user experience, but to enable actual value, you need to integrate with multiple different systems. So systems themselves might be enabled by different bounded contexts, or they might be enabled by third-party contexts. For example, if I'm enabling like a finance system, I might want to use Stripe for payment processing. So, or Twilio for any sort of telephony system. So with any external vendor that I might consume, we always talk in terms of this idea of an SLA, a service level agreement, where, okay, you are going to give me this much uptime, this much performance, and then there is a penalty. So the thought process around the maturity model, and that's the proposal that I'm putting forward, is that why should we not do this? When we talk about these internal needs, these internal bounded contexts that have been created to solve this problem within the organization. So the idea is that we extend this to this SLA that exists even within your organizations of how these systems interact with each other, modeled under something we call the maturity model, which acts as a toolkit to quantify and measure these SLAs over time across these six pillars of quality, of performance, availability, resilience, security, and agility. And the idea is that these metrics need to be actionable and not vanity. And we'll talk about why they're actionable in a bit. Right? So before I go and define some of these metrics and how they work for us, I would like to add this one caveat. The definitions, the words itself may make sense for you and your specific business use cases, but the definitions are context specific. They are around the processes that we have created within our own organizations. To some extent, the processes itself have been created because we have these definitions. And if you do choose to look at a system like this, look at the terminology, you would think about how something like this applies in your own context. So for example, when you talk about quality,
quality is something that derives from end user experience. You report certain bugs, like your users report bugs, or your internal teams report bugs. And you quantify this. All of these metrics are quantified against like a 100% index, which means that a score of 99% means that because of this particular smaller system that you have built, this bounded context, is offering a quality of 99%, which means 1% of the user base is affected in this organization. When we look at things like performance, so you have created this domain team, which contains product managers, designers, engineers, which means you're also charting out certain user journeys during the design process. So when you do that, you are also looking, then what we do is that we also set up what is a satisfactory time for a user to complete the journey that we have designed for them. Okay? What is a tolerable time? So we index performance against these metrics, and we borrow ideas from Aptix scores, if you guys are familiar with that idea. When we talk about availability, we encourage people to think beyond things. The thing beyond the fact that your service is up because you can hit it or hit it against a health check. Domain-driven design and behavior-driven development, something again worth reading about if you haven't already, actually are very go hand in hand. And these behavior-driven development, where you write these acceptance tests, are rich in this common language to which these teams, these domain teams, talk about. So what we do is we use Postman monitors to write acceptance tests against user stories, not against uptime of certain systems. And these availability of each of these user stories is what we quantify against the percentage of users impacted. We talk about resilience. Your system is relying on other systems for its uptime, for its performance. But how resilient are you to the non-availability of your dependencies that you have identified and declared, right? So this is where we use techniques like chaos testing, and even take techniques like consumer-driven contracts and build them in production so you can check how resilient your system is. Security, where you talked about a whole bunch of processes to make sure that security is something that's measured and again quantified against that index. And finally, agility, which acts as a yardstick for our product and engineering managers, where you look at the impact of planning, and we follow this thing called the RISE model for planning, which is about reach, impact, confidence. But another very, very important thing that we measure inside agility is the measure of cross-domain interactions, because now you've created these teams who are directly responsible for delivering user value to the end. So if there is still cross-domain interactions that are happening outside of these API interfaces, it's something that you need to measure, because otherwise your boundaries are still porous. And we discussed that these boundaries need to be hard. Okay? And of course, the whole idea is that once you define each of these metrics, this entire system is only possible if you follow the remaining three principles of microservices design. If you create a culture of automation and invest in tooling that makes your systems highly observable, then you can isolate failure across these systems. Without doing any of this, you cannot build a system that is observable and measurable at the top. And this is what sometimes, not the direct representation, but what it can look like. So coming back to that example of the credit card processing system, which we now split up into three separate domains, being powered by these three services, one is payment, transaction, accounting, and merchant. And you can look at certain scores that have been created against them. And if you define organizationally that, hey, my SLAs for my entire organization need to be 99.9%, so there is a variable degree of processes that need to be created to handle when any of these SLAs get violated. And this is the aggregate view, like the top level view, which you can see to observe the entire system at scale and see where it is not performing. But it can also be extended, and this is what we do, to look at it from the perspective of one of these systems, one of these domains, and see how these different bounded contexts, these other teams that I'm interfacing with, interacting with, am I not able to perform because their systems are not giving me the right set of performance? Right? So again, allows the system to be observable both at a macro level and a micro level from an individual perspective, inside out and from the outside. And that is what makes it measured. So to quickly summarize, what we get from here is a set of actionable metrics. And coming back to tying this whole story together, right, is that why did we start talking about domain-driven design in the first place? Because getting actionability into this metric and making them non-manageable is hard if your system itself doesn't have the right set of separations. And because we have put in thoughts into designing a system, and designing is the keyword, where you start with domain-driven design, you don't just put some non-contextual numbers which everybody within the organization has to optimize. And these metrics then create a feedback and a language around which teams within the organization can negotiate. Oh, am I always supposed to build these new shiny systems, or do I have a system of accountability where I can say that my performance is down? Maybe that is something I can compromise. Because what you really want to do is create a resilient stack of microservices that ensures high quality over time. And finally, domain-driven design works only if these domain boundaries are well defined. It is very, very important to measure the cross-team collaboration that occurs, and the maturity model in terms of So I know it's been a whole bunch of vague terms. I really want to deliberately this thing be vague, because there's a whole bunch of concepts that people don't think about. Because you look at systems for microservices, I've made that mistake. So what this is, I'll share the slides by whichever medium is available. Look at some of these terminologies and try and understand some of these things that help you build a more resilient stack over time. Because this is just the surface and a way to see how this can be used to build a resilient system. But it is not an in-depth analysis. Okay, so please go ahead and follow up with this and see what more you can learn around some of these topics. And that's all. Thank you.
One question. And just to say, next year we'll have a bigger technical room, and sorry for that, but yeah. We have time for one question.
Yeah.
Can you?
Hello. When we say about business domain, if we are building a platform, a technological platform, what is the business domain for us?
So, I mean, like, let's take the example of Postman itself, right? So Postman is also building a technological platform. So the way that we divide our business domain in this case is, again, aligned around generating user value. So for example, one of the products that we ship out is post monitoring, of your APIs. That itself becomes a business domain, okay? Yeah.
One more question. We have the time for that. Okay, cool. Thank you, Ankit. Thank you very much.